to appear before council, and never did get to do that. But toward the end of the day, Ron Kirk came out and was visiting with us, and I got him to autograph the page where he was featured in there. He had not seen the book before.
So you did double duty yesterday. You helped yourself, and you helped the mayor of Dallas.
Well, no, he wanted to borrow the book, and he read some passages in there and brought it back to me, and I'm going to give it to a friend of mine.
Okay, well, what in this book did you find useful?
The whole book, Brian, the whole book. If you're going to believe in a cause, and you know I'm a Reform Party person, this is a good, good book, and thank you, Tavis. I enjoyed it.
Thank you. Hey, can it get any better than that?
No.
You think we had this thing planned?
Yeah, I like this guy in Dallas. Yeah, I like it.
Hi, Brian. How are you?
Good, Tavis Smiley. Welcome to the table. Before we take a caller to, who's Tom Joyner?
Tom Joyner is the most listened to African-American radio personality in the country. We are in 105 markets, heard by about 7 million listeners across the country. And so, in terms of reach, there is no one who talks to more African-Americans on a daily basis via radio than Tom Joyner does.
There he is on the screen. That's in Dallas. Why is he in Dallas?
He's syndicated in Dallas. A great story about Tom Joyner. Tom Joyner was based in Dallas, and for 7 years, flew between Dallas and Chicago every single day, 5 days a week, to do two radio shows. It took, as an African-American, unfortunately, it took him 7 years to convince the powers that be that a brother, so to speak, could do a syndicated radio format. And so he lived in Dallas, and he did morning radio. He'd get off the air in Dallas, run to DFW Airport, fly to Chicago, do an afternoon show in Chicago. He did that for 7 years, Monday through Friday, 5 days a week. After 7 years of getting stellar ratings in both cities, he was finally able to convince the ABC Radio Network that he could do a syndicated show, and now he sits in Dallas every morning and is heard in 105 markets.
I can't tell whether, if he's on right now and he's talking to the audience, let's listen to him. Can you tell me? There he is.
I can't tell whether he's on.
He doesn't sound like he is on. He's probably in a commercial break. We'll come back to him as soon as we know. We got calls here for Tavis Smiley. Anything's game this morning, any item. We'll get to some stuff here in a moment. About Baltimore, go ahead. You're on the Democratic line.
Yes. My name is Joe Dawson from Baltimore, Maryland. And I'd like to thank Tavis Smiley for being here this morning. I picked up his book. And what the question is his strategy. I am 50 years old, and he taught me a strategy that I was doing already. And his book has a way to really fight back with dignity, and that is preparation. And I thank him for being one of those individuals that has put that down for brothers that wasn't too prepared, were just thrown in the fight for social justice.
Thanks.
I just want to thank you.
Thanks, Connor.
I thank you for your phone call. We, Brian, in this book attempted to do, first of all, thanks for having me on Book Notes here recently. We attempted in this book in a very simple and straightforward way to talk to people about the things that they can do to make a difference. We talk in this country all the time about making a difference, but no one, it seemed to me at least, I don't want to take, you know, I don't want to build myself up too much here, but at least in my reading, I had not come across a book that was simple, straightforward, simple, understandable, that told people basic and practical strategies they could use to be an effective advocate. In this country, we have how-to books for everything, how to build this and how to make that and how to find this and how to do this, but no how-to book for people who really want to make a difference in their own lives. And in short order, that's what this book is, and I'm glad to see that people have responded to it.
Got to share a story with you. You know the other end of the story, but Terry Murphy, our vice president of program, told me he was talking to you on the phone the other day, getting this whole thing set up with Tom Joyner, and you asked him something to the effect, what happened to the Book Notes program? Normally when I do things like this, I get some kind of feedback. Mm-hmm. And Terry said, well, there's one problem. It hadn't aired yet.
Oh, yeah. That was a great story. I was like, I've watched Book Notes too many times, been on C-SPAN too many times to have been on, and nobody, my mother didn't call me, nobody called me. I was like, you know, either I'm losing my juice, either C-SPAN Book Notes is in the tank, or that show didn't run. And so as it turned out, as you know, you guys changed the date from what I'd been told originally, but it ran last weekend, and sure enough, my phone voicemail was flooded with calls, so I'm glad to hear that.
Let's listen to, I think Tom Joyner's talking, let's listen a little bit now.
Always been there for him.
How does this show work?
Good question. What you're hearing there, of course, is music that we call old school. Tom's audience is strongest in the 25 to 54 demo amongst African Americans. And it's a show really of entertainment. I joined the program 4.5 years ago after having been introduced to Tom by President Clinton, as a matter of fact. Both of us had been invited to an event at the White House, and I knew of Tom Joyner. Tom Joyner knew of me, but we'd never met. President Clinton introduced the two of us at a White House meeting, and we connected and started working together. But before I joined the program 4.5 years ago, it was a program primarily of entertainment. He plays music. He has comedians. You'll meet the whole cast this morning. But it's a show of entertainment. What we did 4.5 years ago when we got together was change the show from being one purely of entertainment to one of entertainment and empowerment. And over the last 4 years, we've received most of our publicity, not in part because of the entertainment, but in fact because of the empowerment campaigns we've been involved in.
Tavis Smiley up late last night till midnight at the very least. He has a program on Black Entertainment Television every night at 11 o'clock, Monday through Thursday, and you're about ready to go back to Los Angeles.
We wrap up on Thursday nights, and I usually head home for the weekend, but this weekend I'm on the road giving some speeches. I'll be at Morgan State here in Baltimore on Friday night.
And we read earlier that Bill Buckley announced on Tuesday that he's given his last speech in his life.
Yeah, I heard that.
74 years old. We did a 3-hour show with him a couple weeks ago on Book TV. And he kind of alluded to something on that program. He gave up his Firing Line television program. I mean, you're 35 years old. Just getting started. He's 74, and he's hanging it up.
Well, I mean, Bill Buckley is one of the greats, and I say that with all due respect and candor, because while I don't agree with Bill Buckley on everything that he articulates, I have found and argued in one of my earlier books that in this country, if you are passionate about what you believe, and we talk in this book about passion, if you're passionate about what you believe, people are forced to give you listen. They're forced to give ear to what it is you have to say, primarily because of your passion. And Bill Buckley is as bright as they come, is as articulate as they come, and kind of sad to see him go.
We're watching Tom Joyner combing his hair down there. You think this is
he's doing that for television. He knows he's a comedian. He knows he's on C-SPAN. He's doing that just for you, Brian.
College Station, Texas. You're next. Go ahead, College Station. You're on the air.
Yeah, I was talking to the lady earlier that referred to Lyndon LaRouche getting so many votes over Gore.
Yes.
Well, I've never seen it anywhere else but in the local paper here, the Brian Eagle.
Yes, sir.
It was reported that Bradley got 86% of the vote in Texas, and LaRouche 7, and Gore 6. And I've never seen it anywhere else in the media.
Okay, thanks. Well, one of the confusions during this primary season, sometimes there's a beauty contest, and other times they're getting delegates, and we had somebody call and suggested that Lyndon LaRouche had won the Democratic nomination in the state of Michigan, but it turns out that the caucus decided the delegates, and a lot of the Democrats didn't even go to vote in the beauty contest.
Or too many of those. Last time I was here, I think we discussed this. I have a number of concerns about how the primary process works. And speaking of Tom Joyner, we did a series of commentaries on our radio program about the primary process and whether or not really the time has come, Brian, to relook and to rethink at how we do this. I have concerns, as others do, about the fact that two small states, with all due respect, like Iowa and New Hampshire, get a chance to lead the primary process. But specifically, as it relates to this radio program heard by 7 million African Americans every day, there is this question as to why it is that so late in the process African Americans finally get a chance in mass around this country to have their votes heard, when you have two small states like Iowa and New Hampshire that are demographically speaking overwhelmingly white. So it's not just a black thing. It is a matter of whether or not we're going to have states lead the process that represent all of America. And so we've talked about that extensively on our radio program.
We go to Bonifay, Florida on the Republican line. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Hello.
You're on the air.
Hey, I want to tell Mr. Smiley there that I appreciate his comments, and he seems like a very outstanding man. One thing I want to say is George W. Bush will be the next president of the United States. The Americans, if they really want to change, if they really want to change this country, they will vote for George W. Bush.
What do you think, sir?
I think it's an interesting race. I don't know that it's a foregone conclusion that Mr. Bush is going to win the race. I think it's going to be quite interesting. I think, personally, that a lot is going to come out when you get a chance to see Bush and Gore stand next to each other in debate. In that regard, I think Al Gore has the upper hand.
Let's listen a little bit of Tom's. No one's heard him here yet this morning, so let's listen in.
$1 scholarship to help you with your education at Paul Quinn.
Good for him. Nice. I like that.
Yeah.
That's a nice story.
Yeah.
Fourth grade teacher, mom.
Paul Quinn. We had the president of Paul Quinn on yesterday.
You missed this yesterday, Jay.
Blair?
Mm-hmm.
I know he got some calls for enrollment yesterday.
Well, what happened?
Through the roof.
Mm. At Paul Quinn, do you know that the cafeteria is always open?
It never closes. They don't have, like, breakfast hours, lunch hours,
it's
dinner hours.
Open.
Baba, I decided what school I want to go to. I want to go to Paul Quinn's cafeteria. I mean, college.
Paul Quinn's cafeteria.
Cafeteria.
Baba, I decided what cafeteria, I mean, college, I want to go to.
I know the admissions office got lots of phone calls like that. Hello?
Okay. Is this where the cafeteria is always open? I want to come to school there.
It's time for that little known Black History fact.
Lady Shala.
Salah Shabazz.
Provided by Lady Salah Shabazz of the Black Inventors Museum. Today, class, I'm going to tell you about Thornton and Ruth Blackburn. Mm-hmm. Write that down.
Thornton and Ruth Blackburn.
You got that?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Slavery could not keep Thornton and Ruth Blackburn from freedom. In 1833, 2 years after they escaped to Detroit, Kentucky, they were jailed by slaveholders. During Sunday visiting hours, Ruth Blackburn exchanged clothes with Mrs. George French and walked out of jail.
All right.
Fled to Canada.
Yes.
The following Monday. That's right.
It doesn't say Thornton. That.
Exchange clothes.
With Mrs. French, too.
And French, too.
Now, I'm running out of dresses now. Y'all need to make up your mind what you're going to do now. This is, every time I come here, I got to give up a dress. Something wrong.
No, the following Monday, dozens of armed African Americans rescued Thornton from the sheriff, joining his wife in Canada, and they became very rich citizens of Toronto.
Oh, yeah.
I like our version.
Yeah.
Well,
the following Monday. George, and to this day, George still dressed.
You can't get him out that dressy.
I'm free.
Baby, let's play prison dress up again.
All right, class, stop it.
Okay.
What have we learned today?
He likes to wear dresses.
No. Thornton and Ruth Blackburn escaped from jail by dressing up as Mrs. George French, and they fled to Canada
and became very,
very
rich,
citizens of Toronto.
Selling dresses.
And that's today's Little Known Black History Fact, presented by McDonald's. 14 before the hour, the Tom Jordan Morning Show.
Tavis Smiley, what do they do here with this Black History?
Every day on the radio program, we have a segment called Today's Little Known Black History Fact. Those who, as has been said many times, those who do not know their history are doomed to repeat it. And so we try to make sure that African Americans who listen to us every day, not just African Americans, but all those who tune into the radio program, get a chance to learn a little bit of history every day, a little bit of their own history. And so every day we have a little known Black History Fact that's provided to us by the Black Inventions Museum. And so Tom tries to be serious with it, and it always gets off track a little bit with some humor. But there's always a lesson in the humor. One of the things that we believe on the radio program is that if you can get people to laugh, you can get them to listen. If you get them to laugh, you get them to listen. So their role oftentimes, more often, of course, is to get folk to laugh. And then through the Black History Fact and through commentaries and other things, we try to get folk to listen.
What time is your commentary on Tuesdays and Thursdays?
Tuesday and Thursday mornings, I hit at about 8:20 Eastern time.
This morning, you're sitting at this table, you'll do your commentary.
I don't know if we're going to do a full commentary because I don't know. That's a break that Tom will have a chance to talk to you. So we'll talk about a couple things, I'm sure, yeah.
Well, we're going to go to the phones throughout the morning and get your input on this. But one of the things that I must tell you, I smile when I listen to it. He always goes to this guy named Dave Whitman, uh-huh, who he calls D. White Man. And he asks him, What are white people thinking today?
Exactly.
I mean, what is that? What's going on there?
There's a whole bit on the show, as you said, called D White Man. And D is, of course, Ebonic for the. Instead of a lot of folk who use Ebonic saying the, they'll say the word D. D White Man. So D White Man is a segment where actually a very good stand-up comedian who's always touring the country. If you ever hear the name David Whitman in your neighborhood, go check him out. Funny guy.
Is he white?
White guy. White guy. And from Indiana.
Indianapolis.
From Indianapolis, Indiana, where I'm from. And he comes on, does a bit. And Tom always starts out the bit by asking, what's on the minds of the white folk? And David comes on with humor, but always explains to black folk what white folk are thinking this morning. And then we always read a letter or two that we get. And these are real letters that come in from people who listen, who want to ask a D White Man why white people do what they do, why white people think the way they think, why white folk act the way they act. And it's a very funny bit. We were profiled, as you know, a few weeks ago on 60 Minutes. And one of the questions that came up in the 60 Minutes conversation was whether or not sometimes we step across the line, whether or not sometimes our humor can be seen as racist. And one thing that we take exception to, we don't ever, we think, step across the line. And I'm not even a comedian on the show, obviously. I'm a commentator. But I represent the show, obviously. And I don't think we ever step across the line in terms of badgering people. Or saying things that are necessarily mean-spirited or racist, obviously. But there is humor in race, and black folk have been subjected to that. We've also been those who are offering those sorts of jokes. And so it's a show that isn't always politically incorrect, but never a show that's mean-spirited.
If you're a regular C-SPAN viewer, I ask you to roll with the punches this morning. We'll be in and out of calls, and we're going to show a lot more of Tom Joyner in the 8 to 9 o'clock hour, give you a sense of who he is and what they do on that program. And as you know, we've done this for years here, 20 years. We actually simulcast Larry King in 1980, first time in 1980, and simulcast him every year, a couple times a year, until he got his television show over at CNN in 1985, and then the radio show went away subsequently. Weymouth, Massachusetts, on the Republican line for our guest, Tavis Smiley. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. I'm very happy to speak to both of you. There's been a lot made. In fact, you mentioned this morning, and this is for Mr. Smiley as well as a news commentator, about the South Carolina legislature voting, the Senate, I believe, voting to remove the Carolina flag. Mm-hmm. However, nothing much has been made in the press about the fact that in the state of Arkansas, they celebrate, I think this month, Confederate Flag Day. And also in the state of Tennessee, where, of course, Mr. Gore has long been a resident, they celebrate the fact that the head of the Ku Klux Klan, the man who started it, they celebrate his day. And why isn't more made in the press on these issues?
Thanks.
I think that's a legitimate question, and we have I've had the opportunity to address that any number of times before. And let me say at the outset, I am not a defender of the states of Arkansas or Tennessee, and you left out Georgia. Georgia has an emblem of this Confederate flag that flies as a part of its state flag as well. So there are states who do this. I'm not a defender of any of those states and don't live, obviously, in any of them. But I think that the distinction has been that South Carolina is the only state that flies the flag above its state capital. And the state capital, of course, represents all the people. It's the only state that flies it above the state capital, and is the only state, to my knowledge, that has the Confederate flag, not an emblem, not a piece of it, but the entire Confederate flag that flies above its state capital. And I think that's the distinction that many people have made, number one. Secondly, the distinction has been that South Carolina only raised the Confederate flag above the state capitol again somewhere, I'm thinking around 1965, 1966, maybe a little later than that. So all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the Confederate flag made a comeback in the state of South Carolina around the same time, coincidentally, of the Civil Rights Movement. And that was more of a statement about the Civil Rights Movement, not a message of heritage or pride. And so people have taken exception with that Confederate flag in that particular state, I think for those two reasons and more, but certainly for those two reasons.
I spend a lot more time with Tom Joyner here in a few minutes. Who's in the studio with him? What kind of people?
We have on the program today, every day on the program, there's Tom Joyner, of course, J. Anthony Brown, who is the comedian, and Sybil Wilkes, the young lady you see there sitting in the yellow shirt. That's Jay in the background over there with the hat on. Of course, the guy with no hair is Tom Joyner. But they are on the program every single day. And then Monday through Friday, there's a different character that also joins the show. We have a lady named Myra Jay, who has tips every week for single mothers. There is a lady named Miss Dupree, who is our psychic on the radio program. On Fridays, there's a guy named Melvin, who happens to be
Gay. Melvin's on the program on Fridays. And, of course, I do commentaries on Tuesday and Thursday mornings. So every day there's another element to the show that's added, but Sybil, Jay, and Tom are there every day.
Now, earlier on this program, Miss Dupree was supposedly in a bathroom on a train in France. Is that...
I wouldn't doubt it, Brian. She may very well be. You never know with this show, I tell you. You never know.
Marietta, Georgia, on the Democratic line. Go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. This is Zachariah Chamberlain. Calling. First of all, I just want to say, in response to the previous caller, I feel I must, in the interest of equal time, say that Al Gore, in fact, will be the next president. And in addition, the question that I have for you is in regards to this New York Senate race that is so incredibly intriguing. Last night I saw Rudolph Giuliani on Hannity and Combs reiterating the evils of the poor man that was shot, and all the reasons why basically he deserved to be shot, and how we just don't understand the complexities of New York cop life on the street. And I would like to know what your response is to that.
Thanks.
As a black man.
Thanks, you know? Caller.
That's an excellent question. I happened to catch a bit of that myself late, I guess early this morning on repeat. I caught a bit of the mayor on his program on Hannity and Combs. A couple things. Number one, we have invited Mayor Giuliani on BET to discuss this very same issue any number of times. And the mayor, I've seen him on every other television program, every other television network, but for some reason, he has not found it in his schedule to come on black entertainment television to address these very same issues, which I find disingenuous at best. We've offered to accommodate him in any number of ways on any number of days, and the mayor will not find it to come to black entertainment television, which raises the issue as to whether or not the mayor is just writing off black folk in terms of his actions and his attitude, and not even being willing to address these issues in a forum where African Americans have a chance to speak to him directly in a live format. Secondarily, many people, including myself, obviously, have issues with the mayor, not just for what he did, but for the fact he continues in a very cold and callous sort of way to explain away and to rationalize his behavior with regard to Mr. Patrick Dorsman and being an unarmed man being shot by the New York cops. But there are some legitimate issues with Mayor Giuliani. I just wish he'd step forward and address these issues and give African Americans a chance to question him. We're doing a live show, by the way, on BET in New York on next Wednesday, April the 19th, a live show from New York City on this very issue.
We're going to talk to Tom Joyner in Dallas in just a moment when he's on break there at the top of the hour. We go to New Orleans next. Go ahead, please.
Hi, good morning.
Hi.
I'd like to say hi to Tavis.
Good
love
morning.
The show. Love Tom's show. This morning, Tavis, before you came on, there was a gentleman who called in, and his comments were about the flag in South Carolina. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that he said was that they were rallying all different kind of Confederate followers to now raise flags in other places. And I just wanted you to comment on the fact that as African Americans, we have no problem with people individually waving the Confederate flag. Our problem is waving a flag on a building where we pay tax dollars for. I appreciate the fact that he considers the flag as pride for his people and nostalgic and stuff, but for our people, how we suffered under that flag, and just wanted your comments on that, and just keep up the good work. Love what you've been doing.
Thank you. In the fine tradition of the black church, let me just say amen to your comment. I don't know that I can add much to it. It is, for African Americans, obviously, an unrepentant symbol of racism and slavery and oppression, and folk are entitled to their own interpretation. I think you're right. We believe, black folk more than anybody, or certainly as much as anybody, believe in the right to free speech, the right to freedom of expression. No question whatsoever about that. He has a right to wave any flag that he chooses to wave. It is, though, I think, a bit different when a state that is supported by the tax dollars of African Americans offends them on a regular and daily basis, in fact, by raising a flag that they do find to be an unrepentant symbol of oppression. And so I think the distinction that you made is a good one, and I would just say, again, amen to that comment.
Tavis Smiley, I'm told that Tom Joyner is on break and can talk to us. Good morning, Mr. Joyner.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm doing very well.
What's up, Tom?
How you doing?
We picked up on that earlier. We noticed that I have the same problem. Can I borrow that comb?
You want it? Let me get the hair out.
Give us the basics for people who have never listened to you on the air. What hours of the day are you on?
Okay. On the East Coast, we're on 6 to 10 a.m. And in the Central Time Zone, we're on 5 to 9.
Would you introduce the folks in the studio there with you?
Do I have to?
Yes.
Okay.
Go.
Careful what you ask for. You've done some radio programs, but you haven't done this one. Okay. Do you listen to the show?
You bet.
Okay. All right. This lady right here. This is Sybil Wilkes. Sybil Wilkes is the what we call the voice of reason on the show.
And she's also the only person yesterday that said that she watches C-SPAN, so she's on the top of our list here.
Thank you.
She does watch C-SPAN all the time.
Religiously.
Yes. And that's Sybil Wilkes, and please notice her hair.
It was done especially for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I want you to notice the hair because she's gone through a lot. Yeah. All right.
Well, at least we have some.
All right.
Okay.
Whoa.
Okay.
At least we have some.
And the gentleman sitting next to Sybil with all the books stacked up and the shameless plugs of his website, watchoutthenow.com. That is comedian J. Anthony Brown.
How you doing? Hello. And I watched C-SPAN. I saw the one with Tavis was on there.
What'd you think?
Plugging his book.
Yeah, what'd you think?
I loved it. It was great.
Now, Mr. Brown, show us the book you like to promote there. We got to see it.
Yeah. The book is called Church Announcements, and watchoutthenow.com is where you can get it from. Remember that? Church Announcements. WatchOutThereNow.com is where you can get it from. Yeah.
Tom Joyner, for those who don't listen again to the program, what's the purpose? What are you trying to do every day?
Well, we entertain. We entertain and inform and empower. That's what we call ourselves doing. We do it every day to some 7 million listeners, mostly African-American listeners around the country and over. I don't know if you could put how much as a fair question, because the way we do it is, our formula is this: if we can get people to laugh, then they listen. If we can get people to listen, then we might be able to get people to make a change and make a difference in their community. So somewhere in that mix, we do a lot of laughing, a lot of jokes, and then we throw in some information that might empower people to do something for their community.
What role did Tuskegee, Alabama play in your life?
Oh, boy. I didn't realize what a role Tuskegee played in my life until long after I left Tuskegee. Tuskegee is a town full of rich black history with Booker T. Washington, George Washington Carver, the Tuskegee Airmen, and a lot of black people you probably never even heard of that did some remarkable things in life. It's a small black town with a lot of history. That's the town I grew up in. And in that can-do spirit in Tuskegee, probably somewhere down inside me, has driven me to become what I am today.
Now, we saw 60 Minutes do a feature on you a couple of weeks ago. You were inducted into the NAB Hall of Fame a couple of days ago in Las Vegas. You were inducted into the Radio Hall of Fame out in Chicago last year. What do you think's going on here?
You know, ready to die.
Yeah, because when they start inducting you in halls of fame, that usually means you one of three things: you're either dead, you're about to die, or your career is dead. And I'm neither of those three.
Well,
you feeling all right?
Yeah, it's pressure.
And it was very uncomfortable being inducted into both Hall of Fames, you know, but a great honor indeed. Thank you for the roses.
I have a question. You flew that American Airlines jet every day from Dallas up to Chicago to do your afternoon show.
He didn't fly. He tells me he
got on the plane.
He was on the plane.
Down,
he set up.
Sleep, and
he will tell people that he flew the plane every day.
Brian, yeah. I'll answer the question for you on C-SPAN here. Let me hit that jingle.
Which his name is in. Yeah. Yeah.
And I'll tell you on C-SPAN the story of me, the fly jock, and how I flew every day with these arms. Oh, they were tired. Flapping all the way from Dallas to Chicago. Now, every day for 8 years, I did a morning show in Dallas. Then I got on the plane, flew to Chicago, and did an afternoon show. That's how I met Sybil
right.
in Chicago. And then flew back to Dallas the next day to do it all over again, 5 days a week, Monday through Friday. Hence the name Fly Jock.
Now, I shouldn't, now, I shouldn't ask you, who paid for those tickets every day?
I did.
You did?
You did.
It wasn't their idea. And they didn't like, neither, well, here's what happened. It all came from just pure greed. I had two offers on the table. And Brian, as you know, in this business, there's no such thing as job security. So I figured it would be harder for me to get fired from two jobs than it would be to get fired from one. So I had two deals on the table, two offers on the table. I took them both. And so each station figured that eventually I would get tired and choose one. So I had
4 minutes. Four minutes before you rejoin the Tom Joyner.
It worked out for me. And it worked out for both stations, too.
By the way, we're getting a little feedback here, so it may be a little confusing, but you're going back on the air on your national ABC distributed program at what time?
In about 3 minutes and 30 seconds.
Before you go back on, tell us how Tavis fits into all this every day, or 2 days a week.
I know. Tavis and I met at the White House. We were at the White House because Ron Brown, the former Secretary of Commerce, had called black media into the White House to talk about the Clinton-Gore campaign. And that's when Tavis and I formally met. We had met on occasion. And Tavis had a book, and he wanted to come on the show. I said, fine. And he came on the show. He sat right over there and talked about his book, Hard Left. The phones lit up, and I said, something's happening here. These people are really interested in what Tavis has to say. And what he was talking about was politics. Not exactly a very popular subject. But he had people very interested. It was the election year, 96. And I wanted to do a voter registration drive. And I wanted to do something different. Not your normal, you know, if you don't vote, you don't count, that kind of thing. I wanted to do something really proactive. So I said to Tavis, let's get a Lexus and raffle it off. For everybody that registers for the Lexus
can win the car.
Tavis said, now that's a good idea.
But
he said, what you really need to do is to tell people why it's important to vote, and then they'll go vote. I said, okay, let's do that. And what we decided to do was we take this show on the road, and the entry, to enter the show, you had to register to vote, or we would register you to vote at the show itself. And we chose cities where there were some really tight elections that we thought we could make a difference. That was in 96. Now, that became what we now call our Sky Show. The Sky Show is a huge production where more than 2,000 people, before day in the morning, line up to be in a theater where we do a four-hour show. And we still register people to vote, and we register people for a car. Now it's an Oldsmobile. And we've been given credit to registering hundreds of thousands of black people and even making a difference in an off-year election.
Tell us where you are in your own program right now. What's next for your listeners?
Well, we're going to play an old school song, get our boogie on, and we're going to go to the phones. Normally, the people that listen on the radio will hear the music, but you'll see on C-SPAN is what we do while the music is playing. We'll be answering phone calls.
And when will that start?
In about 1 minute.
Okay, I tell you what, we're going to grab a phone call here, and because somebody's been waiting on the line for a long time, and then we'll give you a chance to get a break, and we'll watch you come back on your show. Nashville, Tennessee, you're on the Republican line. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. How are y'all doing?
Fine, sir. What would you like to say?
Good morning, Tavis. How are you?
Good morning. How are you?
Fine. First of all, I would like to qualify myself as a black Republican, okay? I know you probably don't believe too much in them, but I am one. I have a comment and a question. The comment is, I agree with you on the Confederate flag. It needs to be taken down. But one thing I wish you would point out, because so many people think the Confederate flag is only a Republican thing, you need to point out the fact that when that flag was put up there, it was under a Democrat governor who is now Senator Ernest Hollins.
All right, sir. Thanks.
No, your point's well taken, and I've never tried to make the point, I certainly have not, that is a Republican issue per se. It is an issue, I think, of not a Republican, not a Democratic issue. It's not an issue of black or white. It really is an issue of wrong and right. And the flag ought to come down, no matter who is in the State House, Republican or Democrat. It's an unrepentant symbol of slavery and oppression, and it ought to come down.
We're going to listen in on what's going on down in Dallas. Go ahead.
Mind, player.
Oh, player. Monica Lewinsky lost her job at Jenny Craig. You know what this means?
What does this mean?
Every time she puts something in her mouth, she get in trouble.
Every time.
Every time. Oh,
yeah, yeah.
Express yourself at 1-800-JOINER-1, 1-800-569-6371. This is the hardest working man in radio, the Fly Jock, Tom Joyner. 8 minutes, 8 minutes past the hour. Here we go. 1-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who's this? Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, who's this?
This Aaron from Detroit.
Go ahead, Aaron. Express yourself. What's on your mind?
Yeah, I'm trying to find out something about Steve Silk Hurley. Yes. I want to get some samples of his music or something.
Well, the best thing you can do is get the Tom Joyner Old School Mix CD.
That's the best of his work right there.
In stores everywhere.
Okay, I got that already.
All right, well, that's what we got for you, man. It benefits the Tom Joyner Foundation. Plug, 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 C-SPAN.
Hello.
The Tom Joyner Foundation helps keep kids in historically black colleges and universities. If you can't find it in stores.
Plug, plug, plug.
Yes. If you can't find it in stores, then you can go online to TomJoyner.com.
Plug, 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 plug.
Go to the foundation page.
Plug, 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 plug.
Under special projects.
Plug, plug, plug.
And you can order online.
Plug, plug,
the Tom
plug,
Joyner
plug.
Morning Show Old School Mix
plug, plug,
CD.
Plug.
CD.
Plug,
plug. One-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who's this? Hello.
Hi.
Hey, who's this?
Fred Dew.
Fred.
Dew.
Express yourself, Fred. What's on your mind?
Hey, Jay.
Hey,
Phil.
What up,
Dew?
Hey, Fred.
What up, Dew?
Hey, listen, Tom, the Manisi Jewelers here in Wellston, I pawned my ring.
Yes.
And then when I went back, I paid the pawn price. And then when I tried to put it back a couple of days later, and they offered me $35. So I knew then that they had changed my stone. And they're at 6200 Martin Luther King Drive in St. Louis, Missouri.
All right, dude. I'll let you later, man.
All right.
Cut that. Lawsuit. That'll never make the air.
No.
I hope it didn't make seats, man. 1-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who's this?
This is Carol, and you're going to my hometown, Cleveland. Good morning, Tom, Silver.
What up, what up?
Be in Cleveland in the morning, baby.
Yes, you are. And you know what? You guys are too tough. I'm looking at you on TV, and you're all the way live. You know what I'm saying?
We're looking good, baby.
Now, we're going to the metropolis in the flats.
You got that right. You know what? I'm going to try to... I'm going to call out fire so I can come in quick.
Wait a minute. No.
Call in sick.
We told you weeks ago to start going, but you wouldn't listen.
No. Sick.
Sick.
But you know, right now, if you call in sick, it's a little late.
Yeah, it's a little late.
A little late to pull that off. What 800-JOINER-1? Good morning. Who's this?
This is Sonya from Orlando. Good morning, Tom.
Sonya, you got the TV on?
Yes, I do.
You're going to have to turn the TV down.
Yeah, it's down.
All right, Sonya, what's on your mind?
Tom, I'm looking at you on TV, and you're looking good and everything, but I got one question for
you.
Yes,
yes, yes.
Why do you have a comb in your hand if you have no hair?
Sonya, just
Sonya,
go with the bit.
Sonya,
American dream, can't he, Sonya?
Okay,
no,
okay.
Sonya, my hair is coming back. What you have here is...
It's coming back like Richard Nixon.
You got a better chance of seeing Mary Wilson and Diana Ross
coming back. Someday we'll be together.
Is my hair coming back?
Yes.
But you guys look good.
Thank
Keep
you.
Up the good work.
All
Thanks,
right.
Darling.
Bye-bye.
Did you say that? Yeah. All right, Kelly. Express yourself next. 12 past the hour.
V103.
All right. Mm-hmm. Give me 73 and 80. Mm-hmm. All right. 1-800-JOINN1. Good morning. Who says?
Well, good morning, Tom, Sybil, and Jay and around. This is James Honey from Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Good morning.
I tell you that this guy showed that he had recently in Oklahoma City, and it was all the way live, and I'm watching you here live on C-SPAN. Just want to let you know that I'm behind you 110%, and keep on keeping on because you are touching the lives of African Americans.
Thank you, James.
The ones here in Oklahoma, and I'm all the way live behind you.
All right, man. All right.
He's all the way live.
See, when in Oklahoma, them, that's where we had Lakeside.
Exactly. Yeah. You understand. You see the connection.
It's all the way live. It's all the way live.
Yeah, you got it. Exactly.
Tell people that are watching on C-SPAN to turn their televisions down.
Can you put your little phone away?
No. Call my mama.
You can't call your mama.
Your mama dead, man.
Simple. We're on C-SPAN.
How many times are you going to be able to use the dead mama routine? Hey, Louise, come on. My mama's dead, too. Let's move on.
1-800-JOINN1. Good morning. Who's this?
Yes. Good morning, Tom. My name is Tansy Braswell, and I'm calling from Philadelphia.
Hey, Tansy. What's on your mind?
Brian McKnight was here in Atlantic City last month.
Okay.
I handed him a letter, and I had also wrote your show, The Christmas Wish, and I had the opportunity to hand Brian the letter.
And you haven't heard from Brian?
Not a word.
Can I say something to you? Are you sitting down? Let me break it to you, all right? Are you ready? Brace yourself. You ain't gonna hear from Brian, okay? All right? I don't think he even read the damn letter. How about that? Can you live with that?
Jay.
You haven't heard from him because he ain't and he ain't going to.
But I will respond to your Christmas wish letter.
Tom ain't going to write you back.
Yes, I will.
Yes, he does.
I may not grant the Christmas wish because we only do one a week, but I respond to every Christmas wish letter that comes to me.
Are you watching this? This is what Brian did with your letter, right? This is your letter, right?
But you will get a Christmas card from me. <Let's go. laughs> 1-800-JOINN1. Good morning. Who says?
Hi, this is Clifford Smith in Madisonville, Texas.
Man, cheer up, man. What's the dealio?
Yes, Clifford.
Pick it up, man.
Well, man, I'm down and out.
Okay, what happened?
What's wrong, man?
Oh, I've filed two federal lawsuits against this city here for racism, and I can't get no lawyer to help me.
And they're dropping the boom on you, huh?
They're trying.
Yes.
I've fired twice, and it's real racial. You're talking about racism.
Yeah.
Yes, Clifton.
Yeah.
This is the place.
Yes.
That's it. Well, move, man.
Well, I want to move, but I want to get paid.
Okay.
I know, Clifton, but you sound so down, Clifton. We just, you know,
well,
move.
I just got,
you can still sue him and move, can't you?
And you can't sue and be happy? What's wrong?
I just got a case dismissed in federal court. I can't get no lawyer to help me.
How many cases do you have, Clifton?
He said two.
I filed two. We got kicked out of our house. I filed in 94, statute of limitation. I filed in 98, statute of limitation. Mm-hmm. And,
are you drinking out any of these cases? Because it sounds like you're drinking out of a case, too.
Poor man. He's destitute.
Yeah, he is. But he sounds like
you're drinking.
He sounds like you're drinking to me.
1-800-JOINN1. Good morning. Who's this? Hello. Hello.
Hello. This is Robin from Richmond, Virginia.
Yeah, hey, Robin. What's up?
What's on your mind?
I'm calling about how Governor Allen in the state of Virginia signed to have a Confederate holiday.
Yes. In the
month of April. Yes, and it's so upsetting to me because I don't know how no one's not protesting about it. And
nobody in the House or what is it, you guys have the Commons there? Nobody is saying anything about it?
Not that I've heard.
There's no politician who's against this.
None. I have seen or have heard nothing from no politician. It's so upsetting to me.
So it's incumbent upon you to, if I may borrow from Tavis Smiley, do the right thing and start a petition, perhaps, and a drive to speak out against this.
That day. Are you going to work that day?
It's the whole month of April, so I have to go to work.
Oh, it's not a paid holiday?
It's not a paid holiday.
No, it's not a paid holiday.
Oh,
it's,
well, they
it's
don't
the
count.
The whole month of April.
Well,
but
you know what? They might have some good sales. I mean, they, you know they're going to have a good white sale.
You're sick. 1-800-JOIN-1. Good morning. Who's this?
This is Julian.
All right, Julian, what's on your mind? Express yourself.
My question is this. We have all the hype about the South Carolina flag, state flag, and what about the Georgia flag? It's still continuing to fly.
They're working on it.
The banner of, yeah, of the Confederacy.
Martin Luther King Jr. III
is working
on
the
right name.
Martin Luther King Jr.
Martin Luther King Jr.
Okay, I have another point to make.
Yeah.
Okay, go
I'm
ahead.
I'm a black student at a state university. And I went to the president of that university and asked them, could they fly an alternate flag than the Georgia state flag? And he told me that the only way that they could do that, well, they couldn't because they were receiving state funds. So therefore, they had to fly the Georgia state flag. But I found out otherwise from state politicians that there is a alternate flag that the university could fly, but the president does not choose to do so.
You go to the University of Georgia, right?
No, I go to, no.
Where do you go?
Which one do you go to?
Valdosta State University.
Valdosta
State, okay.
And he told you, if we don't fly this flag, we won't get any state funds.
We won't get state funds.
And you found out that's a lie, right?
And you told him, and you went back to him and told him?
No, I didn't go back to him and tell him because that would mess up my political career.
There you go.
Okay.
So you call us, huh?
Yeah.
Well, why don't you go up there and take the flag down?
Yeah, go up there and snatch the flag down. Put the one up you like and let it go.
Advocate politically.
Well, what do you want? Do you want a political career or do you want to stand for something?
Well,
Tavis.
I like to have both.
Yes, that was great.
Uh-huh. Advocate, man.
Advocate.
Join the show. Come down.
No. You are there.
You're there. Why don't you just do it?
Drive over there, snatch that flag down, put the one up you want.
Yeah, well, no, don't put up no. Just snatch that one down. All right?
Okay, because,
yeah,
you know, it could be a little dangerous for him.
Alexander O'Neill and Sherelle.
It's all alive. Yeah, may I have the sports section?
1-800-JOIN-1. Good morning. Who's this?
Hello. This is Tony from Cincinnati.
Hello, Tony from Cincinnati. What's on your mind?
Oh, I'm just so excited to be on TV. But anyway, I want to say that you are awesome.
Would you give a hand to Mary Boyce? You just saw on
Mary
TV.
Boyce.
I just saw Mary Boyce.
Yes.
You are all doing a great job. I have you on my radio in the morning when my radio comes on automatically.
Well, thank you,
and
Tony.
And I wake up with laughter. So that really starts my day with laughter and prayer. That's how I start my day, and I just want to say thank you.
All right, you're welcome. Bye-bye.
That's the best of his work right there.
In stores everywhere.
Okay, I got that already.
All right, well, that's what we got for you, man. It benefits the Tom Joyner Foundation. Plug, 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 C-SPAN. The Tom Joyner Foundation helps keep kids in historically black colleges and universities. If you can't find it in stores, if you can't find it in stores, then you can go online to TomJoyner.com.
Plug, plug, plug.
Go to the foundation page.
Plug, plug.
Under special projects.
Plug, plug, plug.
And you can order online.
Plug,
the
plug.
Top.
That's what they do here.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I like to also show you my nephew. That's Bubba.
This is Bubba.
Right here. Yes. And that's my niece, Allison. And my other niece, Danielle.
And Mary Boyce's children. That's Aaron. That's Kobe.
Tavis, next, 22 past the hour. Tavis up.
Tom Joyner is with us on C-SPAN. It's about 23 minutes after the hour here in Washington, and he is in Dallas. We're seeing him on the screen with his cohorts there. What did our audience just see? Because if you're listening to the radio, Tom Joyner, you're hearing something other than what you were just doing.
Well, that's behind the scenes, Brian. That's what happens. People often ask us, what goes on when the music's playing? What goes on when the commercials are on? You just got a little sample of what happens. We all take hell breaks.
Yeah, we can't show it all to C-SPAN. We really can't.
We take.
might lose your license.
We had to clean it up a little bit, all right?
We take phone calls that'll be played later on in the morning, some instantly, some next hour or the hour after.
What do you find that is the most interesting to the audience that Tavis does when he comes on the show?
Just breathes. for the women of the show.
And right. A few men. They love.
It is the most amazing thing I've ever seen.
Tavis is a rock star.
He's a rock star.
He gets the kind of admiration from our audience that people who star in movies or make hit records would get. And it is
why he shows up late to every show we do.
And then he makes an appearance. He comes out like this.
Yeah, he comes out like, yay!
It's amazing. I mean, he doesn't sing. He's not a professional athlete.
He don't dance.
He doesn't dance.
He's not a movie star. Although he tries to do jokes.
Sometimes he gets caught up in trying to tell jokes, which is a bad move.
And they love him. They love
Tavis,
him.
Now, when you went
through the CompUSA controversy and when you had some impact on that, did that change the way you looked at what your power was down there?
It changed the way I looked at the people that I worked for. Ooh. Because they almost pulled a plug on us for that, and so it changed the tension around here a little bit. Yeah. As for power, I don't call what we do power. I call it empowerment. We've done things like CompUSA, and each time we do it, it shows that the audience is empowered. Well, here comes someone. That's Marcelina.
Hey, Marcelina. Hey, Marcelina. Say hi.
Come on back, Marcelina. Do your dance.
No.
Yes. Every morning, Marcelina comes in and does the running man for me. It's a beautiful thing. Brian, I don't think it's power. Like I said, I call it empowerment. Yeah. Tavis, are you ready with your commentary? We have 30 seconds.
Yes, Mr. John. I'm standing by here live with Brian Lamb at C-SPAN. Ready to go.
Now, Brian, can you see his notes?
he's totally winging it this morning, Tom Joyner.
Yeah.
No. Yeah. He usually comes in with like a big dictionary worth of words to say.
I watched him do his commentary and wondered how he could read the stuff that he writes.
It'll be written on anything. Yeah. You've seen it written on.
Oh, song's out. Okay. 25 past the hour on the Tom Joyner Morning Show. And now here he is in the C-SPAN studios with Brian Lamb. It's Tavis Smiley from BET Tonight and the author of the book. Plug it, Tavis.
Doing what's
church
right.
Church announcement.
Yeah, church. Brian is nice to put a copy of it on the screen as we speak, but I think our audience knows this book quite well, Doing What's Right, How to Fight for What You Believe and Make a Difference, a book about how we can all be advocates and decide in our own lives to make a difference rather than choose to be indifferent. Good morning, Tom. Hey, Jay. Hey, Sybil. How's everybody?
First of all, we have Tavis's itinerary.
We have to read.
Yes. It's at 9:30 this morning, Tavis is in Alexandria, Virginia at the Walt Whitman Middle School. He's the keynote speaker at the lecture hall, and he will do a book signing. Tomorrow, Norfolk. Get ready. At Norfolk State, Tavis is the keynote speaker and book signing at the Joseph Eccles Memorial Hall. Also on Friday at 7 o'clock, Tavis is in Baltimore at Morgan State Student Government Association, Murphy Auditorium. Sunday, Tavis is in Atlanta at the Hillside Chapel and Truth Center. Keynote speaker, book signing. And on Sunday, Tavis is in Savannah.
Jeez.
Sunday night at the Armstrong Atlantic State University. Keynote speaker, book signing at the Alumni Arena.
And Tavis. Did you know that Tavis is also a clue in the TV Guide crossword puzzle from last week, number 27 down?
I saw that.
It says Tavis really? Smiley's Network. How big can you get?
He's huge.
It's big. Yeah. It's big,
you need
Brian.
More books, man.
I wish Jay had thought to do what you did this morning. Bring my little website thing, hold my book up. I got to take some pages out of your playbook, Jay. Tom, I was trying to explain to Brian, I'm not going to do a commentary as such this morning, but trying to explain to Brian and those who are watching how our commentary works on the radio program. And I was telling Brian that I pretty much do every morning the same thing that Brian does here on the radio, on the TV program, rather. And that is I wake up in the morning and read a ton of papers, some ideas I already have in my head before the morning papers, but try to get an idea of what's on the minds of African-Americans and what it is that we can offer in our commentary vis-a-vis the Tom Joyner Joyner show that they might not hear anyplace else throughout the rest of the day. Sometimes there are issues, though, Brian, that you really have to jump into that might be on the front page of the paper. For example, today there is a major story, of course, about Janet Reno failing to get this agreement with Ileana Gonzalez. And we've talked before, Tom, as you know, on the radio program, there are many African-Americans, Brian, who have a real problem with how this case is being handled. There are many folk in the black community who do not believe under any circumstance, for example, that this case would have been strung out the way that it has been, and that the government would have been as patient regarding this case as they have been were this a Haitian kid, for example, as opposed to a kid from Cuba. There is somehow this incongruence in policy, if you will, between how we treat Haitian refugees and how we treat Cuban refugees. And so that's a big story in today's paper, and we could have done a commentary about that this morning. We could also have done a commentary about an issue raised earlier on this program. Mayor Rudolph Giuliani last night, Tom, appeared on the Fox News channel last night and again defended what I think is indefensible, and that is the shooting and the killing, quite frankly, of an unarmed man in New York City. Mayor Giuliani still seems to be apologetic about it, and you have to ask yourself why it is that he would say make the remarks he made, number one. Number two, continue to defend them, certainly in light of his poll numbers decreasing in this race with Hillary Rodham Clinton. But on top of that, he can't seem to find his way to the Tom Joyner Morning Show, Brian, or to Black Entertainment Television, the most seen TV network for blacks and the most heard radio program for blacks. He can't seem to take the time to come to Black America to address these particular issues. There is a story in today's paper, again, about the Confederate flag. I heard you talking earlier, Tom, about the fact that in South Carolina, the Senate, of course, voting to remove that flag, but now it goes to the House, where that measure has failed any number of times. And so we could have talked this morning about the Confederate flag and how this issue does not seem to go away. And in light of what one of our earlier calls, one of the points our earlier callers made about Governor Allen in Virginia approving a Confederate holiday in that particular state. So we wake up in the morning, Brian, and pretty much do what you do to run through all the papers, try to figure out what's a legitimate issue that ought to be discussed today. And sometimes, as you mentioned earlier about the CompUSA campaign, sometimes it's not just a matter of doing a particular commentary, although that is primarily what we do on Tuesday and Thursday mornings, but sometimes these issues are so egregious, they're so intractable, they cause such angst that we turn these commentaries into air advocacy campaigns. And so for weeks on end, we'll talk about the same issue every single day, trying to get folk to become advocates around a particular issue, whether it's going after Christie's Auction House, CompUSA, the Fox Television Network, the U.S. Congress wanting to give Rosa Parks the Congressional Gold Medal. But throughout the last 4 years or so of doing this commentary, we've engaged in any number of advocacy campaigns. But basically, around this time on Tuesday and Thursday mornings, that's what we get into.
All right. You got it, Brian? That's his commentary for today.
Oh, that's it?
That's it.
So his commentary is about what his commentary would have been about.
What a bit about have
any
we done.
Any number of things.
Yes.
Let me get this right. He's done for the day.
That's it.
Jay, are you expressing angst and are you being egregious?
Hold on. Wait a minute. He talked about what he could have talked about.
Right. Yes.
That's commentary.
Right. That was it, man.
He's good.
He's good.
He's good.
Brian, I don't understand it either. It just worked.
And the women right now are just going crazy.
They're moist.
They really are, Brian. They really are. Over Tavis Smiley.
Yeah.
The Smiley Report brought to you by Missouri Tourism.
A little something, something.
Call 1-800-MO-GETAWAY for your Missouri Heritage poster. Missouri has a little something-something for you. Thank you, Tavis.
A little something-something that you gave me, Tavis. Thank you very much.
Tavis! That was funny, Jay.
You the man.
Yeah.
Talked about what you normally...
Talked about what you could have done.
I was trying to explain to folks how the commentary actually works. And, I mean, the whole point of being on air is to explain to folks how this process works.
You broke it down, man.
Yeah,
you were in a commentary spot.
And you saved four commentaries. Yeah. You didn't even waste them, man.
Yeah. You hear one of these on Tuesday, Jay.
Yeah. For those of the C-SPAN viewers just tuning in, we are simulcasting the Tom Joyner Show out of Dallas, Texas. Mr. Joyner, how many different stations are you on nationwide?
I was just about to say, for those who say, what time during the morning show? I know anything about it because you broadcast everywhere. We're not everywhere. We're on in 105 cities around the country. You can listen to us online at TomJoyner.com.
Plug, plug, plug.
I have a question. As a listener to WHUR here in Washington, you cut a lot of, I don't know exactly what the term for them, a lot of these intros into their weatherman here, into the traffic here. When do you, in the world do you have time to do that?
Mm-hmm. Well, Brian,
glad you brought that up.
Speaking of which,
this is about half of what I'll be doing today. These are those intros that I do. What we try to do with this show, this is a show designed for a national audience. Unlike some other shows, the Imus show or the what's his name, Howard Stern.
What's his name? You know,
those are shows that are New York shows that the rest of the country listens to. This is a show designed for a national audience. And what we want to do is make our show as local as we possibly can. So what you'll hear is, after I do the time, and people often ask, well, why don't you just give the hour?
What hour is it?
What hour? When I say 23 past the hour, then I'll fire a button here. And that will trigger the radio stations to do an intro to the traffic, an intro to the news. And sometimes it'll be very personalized about an accident that might be on a certain highway or road. And that's how we make it local.
When do you, though, for instance, I heard you this morning say something about Topper Shutt as a weatherman here, and you said something about Topper, I see it's going to get into the 50s today. When did you cut that for the local audience only here in Washington?
Yesterday.
Yesterday?
Yeah.
And how many stations do you do that for?
105.
How long does that take you?
He left at 2:00 this morning and then came back at 5:00.
Brian,
to do
when
the
I
show.
Tell you I am the hardest working man in radio, I am.
How long can you keep this up?
Well, I'm only 23 years old.
As we say, Brian, just go with the bit.
Go with the bit.
Can you? No. How much time do you have there, Tom Joyner? How much time before you have to do something?
1:55.
I was going to take a phone call here. I think we'll just keep talking to you until you have to go on, then we'll break away and take some calls for Tavis. Where else do you want to take this program?
To the moon.
To the moon. The moon sounds great to me.
Any television in the future?
No.
This could be our test tape, huh?
This is
our test tape,
Let this be it.
Tell
you
us.
Don't know how long it took Sybil to get this hair like this.
Tell us about the D white man segment every day.
Don't ask me.
Ask D white man.
There's a saying in our community that you're not going to believe it till you hear from the white man first. So, oftentimes, I mean, this is very typical. What you hear on our show is what you're privy to on our show is what black people talk about among themselves. Okay, and sometimes we'll say, you know, you're not gonna believe this till you hear from somebody white. We took that and made it into a bit. We got a comedian named Bob Wise. He's a real white man.
Yeah. Very.
And we do a bit about that. Just pointing out the fact. What we get people to laugh and try to get people to think. And what we're doing with that bit is saying to black people, you don't have to rely on anybody but yourselves. You can ask someone of your race. You can depend on people of your race to do business with, to ask questions about. We know things, and you don't have to do that anymore.
We have Tavis Smileys in the community that can answer these questions.
Would you like to tell us about July 29th, Tom Joyner?
He's going back on the air.
July 29th, a big day in your life. He's not talking to us.
Not talking to us. He must have lost the audio for a second.
Why don't we take a call here, because the folks have been waiting, and you can ask Tavis Smiley a question if you'd like, or make a statement. Tampa, Florida, you're on the air.
Good morning. Actually, what I would like to talk about with Tavis is the next election. Mm-hmm. In your on-air Tavis Smiley book that you wrote, you talked about Maxine Waters not having on the next voting, whether or not she would vote for an all-white ticket.
Sure.
We have a problem this go-round. Maxine, we have a big problem this go-round. Of course, Gore hasn't chosen his vice president yet, but I think if Gore really wants to pull in the black vote,
and maybe the oxymoron that you put there, the conservative black vote, which, you know, some of us fall under, he needs to make a wise decision. He really needs to make a wise decision. And just so you and Tom Joyner know, great job on your census program, your on their advocacy. You know, when I look through the book here, I look and I see how many of the on-air advocacies you all pulled off and how many victories you had. The census is still a victory because you still got out there. You informed us what we needed to do in order to be a part of the community.
Thank you for your phone call. She speaks, Brian, of the census. We, in terms of our air advocacy campaigns, the most recent one was one around the census. We did a 42-city tour. Over the course of 2 weeks, the entire show spanned out. Tom, of course, anchored the show every morning from Dallas, as you see him this morning. But the rest of us on the program spread out over 42 cities in 2 weeks, doing live shows, trying to make sure that African Americans in particular filled out those census forms and sent them in. And we are just now getting some numbers on how the country has done on the census, obviously, and not as well as we would have liked as Americans. It's not a black thing or a white thing. It's an American thing, and we have not done as good a job as we should have or could have as a country in returning those census forms. And now we, of course, move to the phase now where those enumerators, those counters, will be bugging you, knocking on your door, asking you those questions that you could have done in the privacy of your own home. But we spent 2 weeks going around the country trying to get folks to fill out the census forms, and so we appreciate your filling out your form and sending it in, as many African Americans did. And that's been the latest campaign that we were engaged in.
Coming up on the Tom Joyner Show on the radio is a soap opera segment. Mm-hmm. What's that?
Soap opera called It's Your World, and it really takes time to explain this, but it's a soap opera that harkens back, quite frankly, and there's nothing revolutionary about it, but it's a soap opera that harkens back to the old days of radio. Tom thought, when he started his radio program, that one of the ways to loop and to get people to listen every day at the same time was to do a soap opera. And twice a morning, this soap opera runs. The same segment runs in the first hour of the program and again in the third hour of the program.
I don't know if he's... Are you listening, Tom Joyner?
Yeah, I'm listening.
Yeah. Want to say any more about that soap opera?
Yeah, the soap opera is called It's Your World. Mm-hmm. And it's based on the two most popular soap operas on television, All My Children and Young and the Restless. So those soap operas are most watched by African Americans, and we satirize that. We have our own villains. We have our own
heroines.
And
Rich people, and it's
kind of funny. Yeah.
How much time you got? You coming to this right now?
I'm getting ready to do it right now.
Okay, go ahead. Okay, go ahead.
20 minutes before the hour, and now it's time for.
It's your world. Hey, don't you know you can't fake it? It's your world. Don't you know it's what you make it?
So, in yesterday's episode of It's Your World, Veronica showed up at Pam's and told her thanks to her testimony. Veronica will be facing perjury charges. Meanwhile, how far is Coral willing to go to get the money she needs? And now today's It's Your World.
It's your world.
So, Coral, what is your decision? Are you willing to earn the money you need to get a work visa? Or do I hire someone else?
Look around you, Maxie. You're a wealthy man. You could give me the money I need in a blink of a cat's eye.
But what would that do to build your character? Besides, I didn't become wealthy by giving my money away. And the name is Mr. Maxie.
Oh, this is no way to treat someone who's always been right by you.
That is precisely the reason I am willing to trust you with such a valuable cargo. Look, Coral. Diamonds. The finest quality. I know I can depend on you to get every one of them safely to their destination.
Stolen merchandise?
My merchandise. Now, will you deliver the package? Or do I let immigration know that you are an illegal alien?
You leave me no choice, Mr. Maxie. I'll make the delivery.
Dr. Hackett.
Hi, Will. It's Pam.
Oh, hello, Pam.
Oh, hello, Pam. Such enthusiasm. Am I catching you at a bad time? I could call back later.
I'm sorry. This is not one of my better days. I lost a patient in surgery.
Oh, well, I'm so sorry. Was it a sudden illness?
No. He had been listed as terminal for quite a while, but still.
I know. You still hoped you might be able to save him. That's what makes you a good doctor. But ask yourself, Will, did you do everything you possibly could?
I did everything I knew to do.
Then that's what matters, Will. The important thing is that you did the best you could do.
Thanks, Pam. I needed to hear that.
Where is it? I know Redbone has a safe, a key to a deposit box, or some clue that could lead me to the money he took from me. He always keeps a lot of cash on hand, and see, I tried the freezer, the back of the VCR, the speakers on his stereo system. Wait! What about the bookcase?
Did you lose something, Nikki?
Redbone! What are you doing here?
I got tired of the hospital, and this is my home. Now, you answer a question for me, Nikki. Just what the hell do you think you're doing?
Well, Redbone doesn't sound happy. Will Redbone lose his temper, or will he find it difficult to get too violent while wearing a hospital gown? Join us again, friends. Tomorrow in Cleveland, when the Sky Show lands for another episode of It's Your World, presented by
ISO Plus. Fabulous hair is a plus with ISO Plus. You too, Smitty Smith, can have fabulous hair, baby. Now, the multi-conditional relaxer kits, because we have got to move these kits. Move them tomorrow in Cleveland.
Cleveland, the Sky Show lands. Cleveland will be at the Metropolis. Yeah. Sherelle will be performing.
Y'all need to be in line
if
now.
If you're not in line now.
Yeah, you, I'm telling
it starts
you.
At 6.
You can play if you want to.
In the morning. Yeah. At the Metropolis. Bring your Coca-Cola bottle caps.
Rinse
because
them off.
Yes, rinse them off.
Rinse them.
We're on C-SPAN.
I know. Bring they understand rinsing on C-SPAN. I watch C-SPAN. I know.
Bring your Coca-Cola bottle caps because when you fill the bin with Coca-Cola bottle caps, Coca-Cola donates $1,000 to the foundation. And the Tom Joyner Foundation this month is helping deserving students that's run out of money at Paul Quinn College in Dallas, Texas.
Where the plus, cafeteria
it's open 24
closes.
Hours a day.
Cafeteria open 24 hours.
Bubba, I foul by school.
Plus, we register people to vote while we register people for a brand new Oldsmobile Intrigue. Oldsmobile drives the vote. Tomorrow in Cleveland, the Sky Show lands. The big Sky Show at the Metropolis. Then this weekend, J. Anthony Brown appears at the Stardome.
Birmingham. Stardome. Two shows Friday, three shows Saturday. Be there. Truck pull in the lobby.
That's this weekend. This weekend, it's a blockbuster weekend.
Yeah.
And guaranteed to be a blockbuster this weekend, Three Kings.
I love
it. All right, hold up. I know what you're thinking. No, this is not Rodney King, Martin Luther King, or Don King. No, it's not that kind of movie.
I love that movie.
That would be a good movie.
Yeah. It's a real good movie.
Yeah,
that would be a good movie.
That would be a good movie.
And they're not going to beat you no more.
Only in America.
Only.
No, it's not the Kings of Comedy, the Barbecue King.
The Mattress King.
The Mattress King.
The Insurance King.
No. It's Three Kings. Three Kings.
Ice
with
Cube,
George Clooney and Ice Cube.
Marky Mark.
Yeah,
or,
good movie.
I'm sorry, Mark Wahlberg.
Guaranteed to be at Blockbuster.
Really good movie.
Right now.
It's a great movie.
Coming up this Thursday. The Thursday morning mom receives $1,000. 13 before the hour on the Tom Joyner Morning Show.
If you're watching C-SPAN right now, Tom Joyner simulcast here on our morning program on this Thursday. Tom Joyner, go back to your soap opera. And the name Redbone, for white people, what does Redbone refer to?
Well, I've been called Redbone.
When you're high yellow.
Okay. When you're lighter.
A light-skinned black person sometimes will be referred to as red-boned it.
You light-skinned it.
Yeah, or light-skinned it.
Yeah.
Now, did you put that character in there, you know, as a, is it sarcastic or what? Give us the reason why you named somebody Redbone.
The name of the soap opera, it's Your World, and we broadcast to African Americans. So in the African American world, there are some people known as Red Bone, and so that's why we have it. It's a fictitious town where everyone does well, hence the name Wellington. So everybody's rich. No, there's no unemployment. In fact, there's a Maserati car wash. You can't bring a Benz up in there.
And that's how you know it's make believe, Brian, because everybody's doing well. There's no unemployment.
Jordan's world.
It's your world.
Yeah. Now, do you have a guide on the website so white people can understand all these little
Yes, we do. Huh? Yes, we do. We break down all the characters on TomJoyner.com. Go to It's Your World.
Do you have any idea, Tom Joyner, how many white people do listen to your program?
No, about six. You make seven.
Yeah. I met one the other day that listened to the show in Wagner, South Carolina. Big fan of the show.
Yeah.
The baseball coach down there listens to the show.
Yeah.
But have you ever, I mean, I know you got 7 million listeners and you often say the African-American community, but have you ever checked to see what percentage of those listeners are white?
There are ways to check, but...
Some of our audience are married. We have no choice.
And then they come to our Sky shows, and that's how we see how many there are out there.
Right. We don't concern ourselves with the percentage of non-African Americans that listen to the show. We do this show specifically and unashamedly for African Americans. That's who we do this show for. And we invite anybody to listen to it, but it is intended for the African American community.
I was telling Brian earlier, Tom, that one of the issues that Leslie Starr raised in the conversation with you on 60 Minutes was whether or not at times you think we step across the line with regard to African American humor, and whether or not sometimes black humor can be somewhat mean spirited and maybe even racist sometimes on the radio program.
Tom Joyner, I have facts here that Sybil will like. It says, good morning, C-SPAN and the Tom Joyner gang. This is great. As a C-SPAN junkie for years and an African-American, I'm delighted with this show. I listen to the Tom Joyner show on my computer and watch C-SPAN all the time at the same time.
Thing, isn't it?
That's a friend of Sybil's right there.
Yep.
You sure Sybil didn't send that?
and if it's a guy, give me his name, would you?
It is not a guy. It's Betty L. Parker of Trenton, New Jersey.
Well, the way my life's going, leave her name too.
Tom Joyner, how much time do we have to before you have to go back?
I'll just introduce a song, and then in 30 seconds, and then you got me for about 4 minutes, and then I do what we call Thursday Morning Mom. Every week, we celebrate Mother's Day. We figure if Mother's Day was good enough to celebrate once a year, it's good enough to celebrate once a week. And Thursday Morning Mom, we read a letter and we award a lucky mom $1,000. Thursday morning mom receives $1,000 next, 9 before the hour.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to a good friend of mine, Mr. Coco Brown. Put your hands together.
He did. Okay, Brian.
You all clear now?
Yeah.
I got another fact here. It says, I believe that the black community is causing more division by the desire to be both separate and equal. You cannot expect to be equal and erase the hate if you continually want to be separate with such things as black entertainment television, black college funds, NAACP, et cetera. Can you just imagine a white entertainment television and an all-white college fund, et cetera? It would be called racism.
It's called Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
and there is white entertainment television. It's called NBC, ABC, CBS, and Fox. And that's why you have an alternative like black entertainment television. But I don't think, though, Brian, it's necessarily African Americans who want to separate themselves. We weren't the ones who came up initially with this separate but equal policy. But it's something that we've had to live with. I will tell you this, that as time goes on and we get further and further away from the initial days of integration, there are, I think, a number of African Americans who are questioning, quite frankly, whether or not integration on balance was a good thing in the first place.
Tom Joyner, we have a call from Atlanta, Georgia, on the Democratic line. Go ahead, Atlanta. You're on the Tom Joyner Show and C-SPAN. Good morning.
Good morning, Brian.
Thanks for waiting.
Oh, anytime. I started staying for work today. I am off from work. Actually, it's my day off. And I turn to C-SPAN, and I see you have my favorite radio station on. and Tavis Smiley, my favorite commentator. And I was just wanted to ask Tavis, I am starting to get into empowering my people myself, and I live in Atlanta, Georgia. Mm-hmm. And I picked a task that I wanted to uptake, and it was voter registration and educating our people why we should vote, mm-hmm. even on off election years, you know, on presidential years. And I wanted to get a reference from Tavis on who in Atlanta is actually partaking in this task already, and maybe I can join them and learn something and then maybe go on my own.
Thanks, Atlanta.
That's a good question, and because I don't live in Atlanta, I can't answer that question as well as you can. One of the things we talk about in the book, obviously, is about knowing of which you speak. You really can't engage in a campaign not aggressively and not effectively without having done some research to find out who, in fact, you do want to join with. And so you don't want to reinvent the wheel. You do want to join yourself with folk who are already trying to make a contribution. I say that the best way to get somewhere is to hook up with somebody who's on the way there. So do a little research, find out who in Atlanta. I know there are folk there. I know when we come there, as Tom said earlier, with the Sky Show, we have no problem registering folk to vote at our Sky Shows, but there's got to be some people in Atlanta who are out front working on that issue, and do a little research, find out who they are, and join yourself with them.
Tom Joyner, what is the Sky Show?
The Sky Show is what we do 30 times a year in different cities. It's an old school show. We have a band. It's a big party. We call it a party with a purpose. And it starts before day in the morning. People are there lined up probably the night before to get in because it's first come, first serve. And we usually have 2, 3, 4, sometimes 5,000 people packed into an arena or a theater, and we turn away people. And It's the most fun you've probably ever had that time of morning. Right.
It's two shows, too. Yeah,
yeah, it's two shows. It's the one you hear and the one you see. And we say it's a party with a purpose because we not only party hard, but we register people to vote. We raise a lot of money for historically black colleges and universities. We just ended our census tour. It's very different.
Do you have politicians on your program, and do you endorse people for offices?
We don't only endorse, but we do lean.
Awfully hard, awfully hard.
Yes, yes. All right.
I'm Coco Brown.
All right, here we go. It's time for Thursday morning. The Fat Cat. They'll be on the cruise.
Yes, they will.
The cruise. Memorial Day week.
Sell it.
888-352-2260 to benefit the Tom Joyner Foundation. On the cruise, Frankie Beverly and Maze, Ashwin and Simpson, Cameo, Gerald LaVert, Jeffrey Osborne, Kirk Whalum, Vesta, Gerald Albright, Clarence Carter, Betty Wright. Did I leave anybody out? Mm-hmm. Gerald LaVert, did I say Gerald LaVert?
Yeah,
LaVert,
yeah. Yeah,
did I say Frankie Beverly?
Yes, you did.
How about Maxie Priest?
No, you did. There you go.
Now you got it.
Okay.
Just add it.
Okay. And all money that's made from this cruise goes to the Tom Joyner Foundation. And the foundation does one thing. We help keep kids in historically black colleges and universities that's run out of money because their parents don't want them to come home.
Help keep a kid
out
of the house.
Well, they've turned the rooms into dens. All right, every Thursday is Mother's Day on the Tom Joyner Morning Show. And we celebrate with a Thursday Morning Mom, brought to you by Kellogg's Great Breakfast in the Morning. This letter comes from Kingsland, Georgia. Dear Tom Joyner, I'd like to nominate my mother, Ruby Bailey, for your Thursday Morning Mom. She's raised 6 children and has never demonstrated anything but love, support, understanding, and generosity to each of us. She means the world to us, and we feel she represents all the qualities of a great Thursday morning mom. My sister was able to open her own insurance agency thanks to the help and support of my mom. My mom's generosity allowed my sister to get a head start in business without the burden of loans and debt. My older sister has suffered through some trying times of recent. Again, thanks to the generosity of my mom, she was able to get back on her feet. Without hesitation or anger, Mom stepped in and helped pay car loans, insurance, house payments, whatever needed to be done to allow my sister the time and support to concentrate on getting back on track. The instances that my mom has supported my 2 brothers as well as myself are too numerous to name. Oh, yeah. The brothers, they
all. You know. it's only a 4-hour show.
She's even gone so far as to give us a blank check to keep just in case of emergency. That's just how generous, supportive.
Blank?
Yes.
To keep.
I bet she didn't give them to them 2 brothers.
That's just how generous, supportive, and trusting she is of us. She has been there for us through thick and thin. We know that no matter what the circumstances, she will be there with love and support. Now we feel it's time we let her know and the world know that we appreciate her. By being picked for the Thursday Morning Mom, we not only will let her know, but we'll let your viewers know what a great mom and truly special person she is. If picked for the Thursday Morning Mom, we want Mom to use the money to indulge and pamper herself. We want her to spend the money on herself and enjoy.
You give her a blank check. Let her decide.
You know what I'm saying? That's the same thing I'm saying. They called you right. to give her something.
Right.
That's a good idea, but they should chip in a little something too now. Come on.
My mom is our role model, and I hope that I can one day be the kind mom she is. She has shown herself to be. Signed, Andre Brown. Ruby Bailey. Ruby Bailey of Dayton, Ohio. Your daughter, Andre Brown of Kingsland, Georgia, wrote this letter, and you're today's Thursday Morning Mom. You'll receive $1,000 from Kellogg's and a grand prize that we will announce next week for the Thursday Morning Mom of the Year. You see, Brian, we celebrate Mother's Day once a week. We also celebrate Father's Day. That's on Tuesday with Real Fathers, Real Men. Mothers get $1,000. Dads get $500.
Well, you know.
I know.
Which would happen if he had $1,000 anyway? He'd end up with
$500. So in this case,
we cut right to the chase.
And then on Wednesday we celebrate Christmas once a week, and we grant Christmas wishes where people write us letters and tell us what they want. Because we figure if Father's Day, Mother's Day, and Christmas is a good holiday enough to celebrate once a year, it's good enough for us to celebrate once a week. On the Time Joiner Morning Show. It's part of what we do. The Thursday Morning Mom brought to you by Kellogg's. Great breakfast in the morning.
Love doing that.
Yeah, I do. Want me to do it again?
Yes, please.
Great.
Oh, good.
That gets it for you.
Yeah, it does. That's it for me.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard that sound, Sybil?
Not from my lips. Time
William Shatner here. You're not going to believe what Punchline's about.
If you've just joined us, we're simulcasting the Tom Joyner Show out of Dallas, Texas, heard in 105 markets across the country, listened to by some 7 million African-American peoples and a few white people in a week's time. Tom Joyner at his console. I'm afraid to pause. I'm afraid what Jay Anthony Brown's saying.
One of us,
Brian.
Raise your caps off.
Tom Joyner, if people have just tuned in, introduce us again to your crew there.
Okay. Ladies first. This is
Jay Anthony Brown.
This is Sybil Wilkes. This is our journalist and voice of reason, Sybil Wilkes. And our in-house five-day-a-week comedian, Jay Anthony Brown. Not with us this morning are Myra J. and Miss Dupree.
And Melvin.
Oh, yes.
Oh, you got to tell about Melvin. Melvin.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, you wouldn't see Melvin anyway.
Is Mary Boyce still sitting in the studio there with you?
Mary Boyce is there. Yes. You can see her back of her head.
We want
curly braids.
We want to thank David Starr and Ladore Frank. I guess they're your two producers there?
Yes, those are my two producers and assistants.
And can we mention our engineers?
Ross Allen, because I'm tired of him holding up signs. Yeah. I really am.
And Dr. Rock.
And Dr. Rock.
Yes, and Marcelina, you saw her when she came into
in
the
In L.A., show. From L.A.
Tom Joyner, what markets in the United States do you have your most listeners? Where's the concentration?
Our largest markets are Chicago, Philadelphia, Detroit, Washington, D.C., Cleveland, Atlanta, Miami, New Orleans, Charlotte, North Carolina, Nashville, Tennessee.
Columbia, South Carolina.
Can I go on? They're all very, very, very strong. We usually rank in the top three of morning shows in most markets that we're in.
Our producer here, Joya, is trying to get me to ask you about your July 29th wedding, and I keep trying to ask you, but you keep avoiding that. Would you like to explain that to me?
That's what's known as a little player hating that.
Can you feel the love, Sybil?
Oh, Bubble Boy, tell us about the wedding. Yeah, come on.
Brian, that's what we call
hating.
That's hating.
You
hate.
Right.
You
Brian Lamb, I love you.
I get married on July 29th. My fiance is the fitness expert who's seen on the Today Show. And as a matter of fact, she'll be on later today, this morning. Her name is Donna Richardson.
And you had to say that or else you couldn't go home, right?
That's the only thing she'll be on later today.
We have a call from East Lansing, Michigan on an independent line. Go ahead, East Lansing.
Yes, I'm kind of confused. Sometimes this is nothing against I know it's when black speakers get, especially on the Democratic side, usually in a black circle, blacks usually make fun of gays just as much as white conservatives. And also I'm kind of surprised when we have black speakers talk about racism, they never bring up the fact that a lot of Asians, just as racist as whites, you know, a lot of Asians don't want to deal with blacks just as much as white people. And sometimes when we always mix them up with us talking about, well, they should be protected too, but they just thought, I mean, a lot of Asians just as racist too. So I don't know why we never bring those issues up.
Tom Joyner, what do you think?
I don't understand it. To be quite honest with you, what was he trying to say?
You might want to talk about Melvin, though, Tom, and how he fits into the show on Fridays.
Homosexuality.
Oh yeah, okay. Speaking of gays, we have a Love Line section on Fridays when we're not on the road. It's called Melvin's Love Line. And Melvin is a hairdresser.
Festive.
He's a hairdresser. He's very festive. He's still in the closet.
That's why he doesn't travel with us.
He doesn't travel with us. If this were a Friday, you would not see him. Because Ellen's out the closet. Melvin's in the closet. And he gives love advice.
We celebrate him.
Got to grab a call from Louisville, Kentucky, because we don't have much time. Go ahead, Louisville.
Yes, I'm calling about federal mandatory minimum guidelines, whereas I would like to read something for you. One out of every three African-American males between the ages of 18 and 34 in the entire country are under supervision of the criminal justice system. And in 1993, the Gallup poll found that 94% of federal judges disapprove of mandatory minimum sentences. And I'm with a national organization called FAM, which is Families Against Mandatory Minimum Guidelines. And I was just wondering, what type of comments do you have, or do you all support?
Tavis Smiley?
Yes, it's a good question. Speaking of commentary, we've raised that issue any number of times on our program. The real problem with prison overcrowding is exactly what you alluded to, that you have these mandatory minimums I think, quite frankly, look at the drug problem in America the wrong way. We look at the drug problem in this country first as an issue of criminality, when it is first and foremost a health consequence. These folk need help, and locking them up and giving them these mandatory minimum sentences is the wrong way to approach the problem, number one. Number two, it does take away from judicial discretion, as you mentioned a moment ago. And so judges no longer have the discretion in a case-by-case basis to make a decision that's best for the family and for the person who is in question and who needs help. But finally, there is, as long, I should say, as there is this huge disparity between crack and powder cocaine sentencing. For example, it takes you have to get caught with 100 times more powder cocaine than crack cocaine to get the same sentence. That is racist on its surface. Something must be done about this disparity between the sentencing between crack and powder. But there are some legitimate issues here that ought to be discussed. I hope, though, that some of these issues will get some traction in the debate between Gore and Bush. But we ought not to let these mandatory minimums go by the wayside. There ought to be some real debate about this. But ultimately, it hurts African-American people in many, many respects. And we've raised this issue on the Joyner Show many times before, and we'll continue to raise it until something gets done about it.
Tavis Smiley is here in our studio. Tom Joyner is down in Dallas. I'm not sure whether he can talk to us or not. Can you talk to us now, Tom Joyner?
Hey, man.
How you doing?
Hey, Tom, congratulations.
Why don't we go ahead and listen to his phone calls for a while?
For the Sky Show on the 28th.
Yes, we're coming to Dallas on the 28th, 2 weeks from this Friday.
And isn't War performing?
Dun, 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 dun.
The
War.
World is a ghetto.
Okay, well, maybe
I was slipping into darkness.
Hey, you know what? Hey, that weekend, it's the mayor's
convention.
Yes.
That's right.
And I heard that Governor Bush has already said that he will be here for that convention. So y'all tell Tavis to bring his briefcase. Okay?
All right.
Taking a look at the weather. It's cloudy here. Highs in the mid-60s.
All right. Let's go to Chicago. Who's on the air in Chicago?
Good morning, TJ. It's Andre Salas from B103.
Step aside.
Hey, first of all, TJ, Sybil, Jay, I want to congratulate Tom on your induction into the NAB, brother.
The NAB Hall of Fame, thank you.
Yes, sir. And also, I want to let you know now, I'm having a big Taurus Steppers birthday celebration at the Raz, April 29th. I just thought maybe you might want to know
really?
That.
Really? Okay, yeah.
You and Jay have a lot in common. Plug, shameless plugs. What's the weather in Chicago, Andre?
All right, JC Funky Fashion Forecast.
It's Steppers
forecast.
Weather, isn't it, Dre?
Say what?
It's Steppers weather.
It's Steppers weather. Of course it is. And it's going to be even more so on April 29th. Okay. It's going to be partly sunny. Warmer, too. We're going to get up to a high of 60. And that's the JC Penney Funky Fashion Forecast.
All right. We're going to be in Cleveland tomorrow. Who's on the air in Cleveland?
This is Ralph Pooh. How's it going,
Ralph?
Are they lining up for the show? Ralph, are they lining up right now?
They lining up right now, Tom.
Sherelle's going to kick it off at 6 in the morning.
That's right. At the Metropolis in the Flats, on the west banks of the Flats. That's right. We're ready for you, Tom. And, hey, I'm watching you on C-SPAN. You're looking good, baby.
Yeah.
Yes, you did. There you go, Tom. All right, I caught that. Okay. So we're looking for you tomorrow in Cleveland. Hey, and bring some extra kids because people in Cleveland, they haven't had one since last year.
Oh, yeah, I know that's right. Since last year?
Since last year?
Yes, since last year, Jay. You'll see tomorrow. The J.C. Penney Funky Fashion Forecast calls for some sun and some clouds, a high of 54 degrees, overnight low of 44. Currently, a WZAK Cleveland's R&B leader is holding at 34 degrees.
And that's the Funky Fashion Forecast. Podcast brought to you by J.C. Penney.
It's got the look, baby. Can't tell you how many times.
No. Can I give me a second song? Express Yourself next. 9 past the hour. W-Q-B-E-V. Let me see page one, please.
Tom Joyner, what you got time now, or you what are you doing now?
1-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who's this?
Good morning. This is Tamela Leitner from Toledo, Ohio.
All right, Tamela, express yourself. What's on your mind?
I just wanted to say it was an honor to speak with you guys this morning. Hi, Sybil. Hi, Jay.
Hi, Tamela.
Hey.
You guys are doing a beautiful job. It's nice to see Brian, Mr. Brain, and that you guys are having some very positive African Americans on our television. And that made me have a very different outlook about C-SPAN, and I just wanted to share that. And also, too, hi, Travis.
and to his brother, Tavis.
I'm sorry.
You're going to watch BET and C-SPAN now.
That's
all right.
Right.
1-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who says?
Good morning, Tom.
Hey, who says?
My name's Larry.
Larry, what's on your mind, man? Express yourself.
I'm calling about the census.
Uh-huh.
I have a friend of mine that recently gave a census party, and
that's a good idea.
To get in, you had to bring your census or $3 to get in.
Oh, that's a cool idea. Sounds like a rent party.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, we played cards and whatnot, and there was food served, and then there was a break in the activities.
Who collected the $3?
The $3, right.
Then we had people at the door collecting it.
Yeah. What people, bro? We're talking to the people right now.
We're moving right along here.
You were the people.
But there were a couple of concerns that were brought up.
The concern is what happened to the $3. $92.93. 1-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who's this? Hello.
Who's there?
All right. 1-800-JOINER-1. Good morning. Who's this?
Good morning, Tom, Sybil, and Jay. This is Ken, the cookie man in Atlanta.
Whoa, Ken. Aren't you Ken, still on Ken, probation? You're on probation, man.
Oh, we said a month. It's been like 2 months.
That's how we count here, Ken.
We count by twos.
You're on probation.
You're still on probation,
you're
man.
You're still on probation. You cannot come on the show
yes.
until after we return from the cruise.
Cruise, right.
serious, Ken. You can play if you want to.
Ken, we can't let you on the show.
We wish we could. Then we'd have Jimmy the Joke Man calling.
And yeah, he sent his best.
No.
For those C-SPAN watchers, this is Ken the Cookie Man.
Who calls all the time.
All the time, and we put him on probation.
For a bad joke.
Yeah,
so you're on probation, man, until we come back with from the cruise.
Yes, Ken, I'm sorry.
And when do we come back from the cruise? In December?
Sorry, Ken.
I've been working on my material.
Okay, keep working.
Can we give him a chance?
No.
Okay.
C-SPAN's here, C-SPAN. Let him have
you
a
hearing. You know what? I'm warning you out there.
This determines whether or not you stay on probation or are banned from the show forever.
All right, you put it all on the line, Ken. Let's hear it.
Okay, this is my beef. I got a problem with the local weatherman, his little flaky five-day forecast.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even plan a weekend. Check this out. At the beginning of the week, Saturday and Sunday has little smiley, sunny faces. By midweek, they snuck in some clouds. By the time Friday rolls around, Saturday and Sunday's got black clouds with lightning bolts and cats and dogs coming out of them. I mean, let's be real. If it's a true five-day forecast, he shouldn't have to do it but every 5 days. I mean,
you're looking at a lifetime suspension, man.
What did I say? What did I say?
Lifetime.
Did you not listen to me?
Let's be real. I don't listen to you.
Tom,
you make a nice cookie,
let
man.
Let me, please, please. Huh? I told you. What did I tell you? I felt it.
You tried to tell him. Never again, right?
No.
That made me have a very different outlook about C-SPAN, and share that, and also too.
All right. 1-800-JOIN-1. Good morning. Who's this?
How you doing?
Hey, who's this?
It's Mike McCullough from Wheaton, Maryland.
Mike, go ahead. Express yourself.
Yeah, I'm calling about that Confederate flag.
Yes.
Hey, when they seceded from the Union, doesn't that make them traitors?
Yes.
Okay, in a sense, and also... Well, traitors, being a traitor, you get punishable by death.
Yeah.
And then they lost.
And they lost the war.
Lost the war.
You ain't got to preach to me. Why is the flag up there?
America's never associated with losers.
That's right.
You know, Minnesota Vikings and the Buffalo Bills, four-time losers, you don't associate.
Do they get a ring? Right. I see what you're saying, man.
They're not flying their flags out.
You know, I just don't understand that.
You got a good point.
It makes a good point, man.
And 95.
Moving right along with the $3.
The concern is what happened to the $3.
$3 up there.
All right, let me have Brian Lamb back.
Tom Joyner is with us from Dallas. We're simulcasting this program. About running out of time here, Mr. Joyner. We're going to have to take leave. Tava has to go make a speech.
Yes,
and book signing.
Book signing, yes.
This is at elementary school for kids. There's no book signing. They're just talking to the kids, you know.
Will you sign this for my mother?
Yeah.
Tom Joyner, will you do this with us again sometime?
I would love to. This was fun.
Give us advance notice, please. We just need to know how much time do you need,
Sybil?
Well,
about 3 weeks.
I need some time, you know, to get the hair and
flown in.
Yeah. This is real, America. It's mine. Tell them the truth.
That's a real good weave.
Stop.
Sybil Wilkes, J. Anthony Brown, and Tom Joyner in Dallas. Thank you very much for being with us.
Bye, everybody.
Bye, America.
And now back here in our studio with Tavis Mai. Tavis Mai, we have to let you go.
Thank you, Brian.
Is it like this every day?
Every day. It is raucous every day. It is, as Tom said, every day, a party with a purpose for 4 hours every single morning. And again, we figure that if we can get people to laugh, we can get them to listen. And so I think this morning you got at least a bit of a flavor of how the program works with the jokes and the entertainment. But you heard Tom talk about raising money for kids in college. You heard Tom give away money for single mothers and all the other parts of the program and our commentary allowing people, we hope, to be enlightened and to be encouraged and even empowered by the words that we speak. And we think it's a good mix that works pretty well, 5 days a week, 4 hours every day, and we are just trying to, as Tom said, to take it to the moon.
Tavis Mai, born near Kokomo, Indiana, a Hoosier by birth. Here's his book. It's called Doing What's Right. It's in your bookstores. He was our guest last week on Book Notes, and we thank you very much for coming in today.
Thank you, Brian.
to have a smiley. Tom Joyner. We'll take a break and come back with Michael Walton and talk about the weekend here in Washington, which could get interesting.
This week.